This one is definitely an involved problem. It asks for the equilibrium constant, which, just so you know, is determined by using this equation. The equilibrium constant K is equal to E, which is something called Euler's number, spelled Euler's number, raised to this exponent, negative delta G naught divided by R times T. So in order to calculate K, I have to first of all figure out what delta G is. And then I can insert R, the ideal gas constant, and the temperature for this equation in there, which is 298 K. But how do I figure out what delta G is? Well, to figure out delta G, I have to use this equation. So delta G is equal to delta H minus T delta S. So in order to do this, I need to figure out what delta H is. Separately, I need to figure out what delta S is. And then I need to take those two numbers and insert them into this equation to solve for delta G. Then I take delta G and insert it into this equation to figure out what K is. So it's a long journey. That's where we're going to go, okay? So these are the equations we're going to have in mind. I've looked up, using the table that is given to us, the H of formation values for each of these substances, as well as the S or entropy values for each of these substances. How do we calculate delta H? We use this equation. Delta H for the reaction is equal to the sum of these H values for the products minus that of the reactants. And these epsilons here mean sum of, okay? So here on the right side, my products, I've got negative 395, but I have a coefficient of 2 here. So I'm going to take that negative 395 and multiply it by 2. There's only one product here, so that is the sum of all my delta H formation for my products. Make sense? Now I'm going to subtract the sum of all of my reactants. Conveniently, delta H is a formation for substances like this in their elemental states and physical states, liquid, gas, and solid, are 0. That is not true of S values, of entropy values, but is true of enthalpy values under standard conditions as these are. So I don't have to worry about adding a 0 in there. It won't make a difference. But I do have to worry about this. I've got 2. I have a 2 coefficient. I'm going to multiply it by the negative 297. Now, please keep in mind that the units here for the delta H are kilojoules per mole, which I haven't written down here because I've tried to save some space, but that will be important in just a moment. So here I've got my sum of all my delta H's of products minus that of reactants. Make sure you don't mix up your signs, negative, positive. Enter them in all very carefully, if needed, in multiple lines on your calculator, and you should end up getting for your delta H for this reaction negative 196 kilojoules per mole. So I'm going to make note of that, write that down somewhere so that we can see it, and then clear the board so that we can start to work on our delta S. So using the analogous process for our S values, which have units of joules per mole Kelvin, or as I like to say, joules per mole, I'm going to take my 256 here. This is my product, and I'm going to multiply it by 2. So I'll take 2 times 256. Then I'll subtract from that the sum of my reactants. I have an implied 1 coefficient here, so that's going to be 1 times 205. I can just write 205 there. And then I'm going to add to that 2 times 249. So you should end up with that. I take that very carefully through my calculator, and I should end up getting negative 191 joules per mole Kelvin as my answer for delta S. So I'll go ahead and make note of that up here, and then we'll clear the board for our next stage of work. So for the next phase, I'm going to need to take or solve for delta G by taking these terms and inserting them where they go in this equation. There's a problem, however. It's that delta H here has units of kilojoules per mole, whereas delta S is joules per mole Kelvin. Okay, those don't match. So I need to push in one direction or the other, pick either joules or kilojoules. Which one am I going to pick? Well, I think for me, the answer is going to come down to the identity of R. So R, the ideal gas constant that we're going to use for this equation, is the ideal gas constant in terms of energy, which is 8.314 joules per mole Kelvin, okay? So the ideal gas constant in this case will dictate to us which units we need. And you can see it has joules in it, so I need to push my delta H towards joules. Does that make sense? So if I take this number and multiply it by 1,000, I'm kind of skirting or shortchanging my dimensional analysis here to save time, I will end up getting my delta H as being negative 196,000 joules per mole. And now we're in units of joules per mole on the delta H. Hopefully that's okay. So delta G then is going to be equal to this delta H minus the temperature, which is 298 kelvins, multiplied by our delta S here. And I guess if you want to keep track of units, I will. We'll write out our kelvins there. Our delta S here is negative 191 joules per mole Kelvin. You'll notice that my kelvins here, cancel out my kelvins down here, and I'll end up getting joules per mole as my overall units. You take the negative 196,000, subtract from it these two terms multiplied by each other, and you end up getting negative 139,000 joules per mole kelvin, okay? That's my delta G. We'll now make note of that, add it to our list, and then we'll take that and insert that term up there where it belongs in that equilibrium constant expression to finally answer this question. So as I just pointed out, the equilibrium constant expression is going to be equal to Euler's number raised to the negative delta G divided by RT. So let's take this equation, bring it down here, and insert all of these terms necessary where they belong, okay? So there's the entire thing. You can see that it's very complicated, and it's very easy to get it wrong if you try to do it all in one step. I strongly recommend simplifying this entire term first, getting a number, and then using that number or raising Euler's number to that number, okay? You'll notice unit-wise, everything cancels out. My kelvins over here cancel out my kelvins there. My joules per mole here cancel out joules per mole here, so that my final equilibrium constant ends up being a unitless number or term, which it should be. So what we'll do now is simplify this stuff and see what we get, and then we'll raise Euler's number to that term. Make sure when you do so that you don't forget that this is a negative of a negative, so they cancel each other out, leaving you a positive term in the numerator right here. So I've got 139,000 divided by 8.314 multiplied by 298. So I end up getting 56.1. So I'm gonna take Euler's number, raise it to 56.1, and see what I get. Now, in case you're struggling finding Euler's number on your calculator, it's usually attached to the natural log. So Euler's number and natural logs are kind of the antithesis of each other, I guess. So if you find your natural log or LN button on your calculator, Euler's number might be above it. So you might have to hit a second button and then the natural log button to find Euler's number. Anyway, I take Euler's number, raise it to the 56.1, I end up getting something around 2.32 times 10 to the 24, and this term might end up, or this number might end up being a little bit different depending on where you rounded or didn't round. But anyway, that's what I end up getting, somewhere in that ballpark, 2.3 times 10 to the minus 24. And of our multiple choice lineup, the one that matches that most closely is answer A.